We've already had a few videos talking about using the Laplace domain for studying analog systems. First, you can find the output for any given input if you multiply the Laplace domain input by the system's transfer function. Second, you can use the system's poles and zeros, particularly the real components of the complex poles, to determine whether a system is stable. Now we're going to gain some intuition about a system's output for a wide range of inputs, particularly input signals of different frequencies. To do this, we use the system frequency response. We'll define the frequency response and explain how to find it from the Laplace transform using a geometric approach. The frequency response is very important for engineering a system. Many systems are designed to process signals at different frequencies, like Wi-Fi, AM and FM radio stations, and even voice audio signals. If you have a linear time invariant, or LTI, analog system, and you pass it an input of some frequency, then the output is going to have the same frequency. The magnitude can change, and the phase can change, but the frequency will be the same. Let's talk about figuring out how the magnitude and phase change. We start with the Laplace transform, which converts the time domain signal into an S domain signal, where the S is complex. If you drop the real component of S and just use the imaginary component, J times omega, then you can rewrite the Laplace transform as big F of J times omega. You still have the integral over time, and the complex exponential becomes an imaginary exponential. This version of the transform is known as the continuous Fourier transform, and there's also the inverse Fourier transform. The Fourier transform is also known as the frequency response, or the spectrum, and it can be seen as the Laplace transform solved only along the imaginary s-axis. If you take this back to looking at systems, we can rewrite h of s, the system transfer function, as h of j omega, where we then replace all the s's in the transfer function with j times omegas. This is now the system frequency response, and we can calculate its magnitude and phase at a particular frequency to see how it would convert an input signal into an output signal. Now, if you're really comfortable with complex algebra, then you can work this out directly from working with the h of j omega. But it's really insightful to work out the frequency response geometrically from the complex S domain. You can see h of omega as the transfer function gain k times a product of zero vectors, all pointing to the imaginary S axis at frequency omega, divided by a product of pole vectors, again all pointing to the imaginary S axis at frequency omega. Finding the frequency response can be done by working out all the pole and zero vectors and finding the magnitude and phase associated with each vector. There are two main results that you can use here. First, the magnitude of the frequency response is found by taking the gain, multiplying it by the product of the magnitudes of all the zero vectors, and dividing by the product of the magnitudes of all the pole vectors. Second, the phase of the system is found by taking the sum of the phases of the individual zero vectors, subtracting the sum of the phases of the individual pole vectors, plus pi if the gain k is negative. Solving a full example with this approach can be quite involved, so we'll do one in our next video. Thanks for watching. Let me know if you liked it. You can leave feedback in the comments or subscribe for more videos. There's also a link to lecture notes in the description. See you next time.